The first criteria to be an ideal gas is we're going to say the size of the particle is significantly small. When compared to the volume of the container. What does this mean? That means if you look at all this volume inside of this container. If you compare the size that's free to the size of each gas particle, you're going to say the gases really don't take up that much room. That's what it takes to be an ideal gas. So the first criteria is the gases have to be very small and there has to be tons of room around, because an ideal gas assumes that it's alone. It acts as though it's the only person there. That's what an ideal gas is. An ideal gas is kind of like a diva. It only thinks it's by there by itself. No other gases are around. No other gases matter. The only thing that's important is that particle by itself. So if we think of this, usually an ideal gas will take up about less than 1%, usually about 0.0% of the total volume. Okay, so an ideal gas, an individual gas particle, would take up usually less than this percentage of the total available space. The next thing to be an ideal gas, we're going to say the average kinetic energy of a particle is directly proportional to the temperature of the container in kelvins. What the heck does that mean? Well, that means an ideal gas, when we increase the temperature, that increases the average kinetic energy of that gas. We've said this before. We increase the temperature to a container, the gases absorb that thermal energy and convert it to kinetic energy. So they have greater kinetic energy. Now, this is going to be different from velocity. Velocity and kinetic energy are different. If we increase the temperature, we don't increase the speed of those gas particles. All we're doing is increasing their kinetic energy. We're making them vibrate at a higher frequency, a higher level. So they're shaking more. Velocity comes from weight, not from temperature. So remember that. Increasing the temperature increases the kinetic energy, not the velocity or speed. To increase the velocity or speed, you need to reduce the weight of the gases. The less you weigh, the faster you move. Now we're going to say the collision of a particle with another gas particle or with the walls of a container are completely elastic. That means that when the gas particles are hitting one another or hitting the walls of the container, they bounce off. Kind of like ping pong balls inside of a container. They're all bouncing around, but none of them are sticking together. Okay, so to be an ideal gas, when you hit another ball, another gas particle, you're not supposed to stick to it. We're also going to say because they're completely elastic, once they bounce off each other, there's a transferring of energy. So gas A hits gas B. Gas A is going to transfer its energy to gas B. B is going to transfer its energy to gas A. There's a transfer of energies. So no energy is lost. This is what we mean by the third criteria to being a gas law. And so what we are going to finally say is these are the three criteria you need to follow in order to be an ideal gas. Your professor more likely will just give this to you as a theory question. So you just have to remember, to be an ideal gas, you have to be very small compared to the total volume. To be an ideal gas, your average kinetic energy is influenced by the temperature, not your speed or velocity. To be an ideal gas, you're bouncing off the walls or bouncing off of other gases, but you don't stick. You just are bouncing around.